All right, you guys, welcome to our first week of distance learning. I hope that you guys are starting to get the hang of it. If you have any questions, obviously reach out to your teacher, and I'm sure that they will get back to you very quickly. So we're going to be learning about the European system of governance and economic system prior to the Renaissance. So this happened mainly during the Middle Ages, so I'll give you a little bit of a background on it. And then we're going to be learning later this week about other systems of government and economic systems in other parts of the world. So we will be looking at Middle East systems of government, and then also we'll be going to Latin America and looking at the Aztec system. So let's get started with what's called the feudal system. Again, we are talking about this in reference to Europe. So first of all, before I start this lecture, you're going to want to have pulled up while you're listening to this and looking at the slides, you're going to want to have in a separate tab, and you're going to have pulled up these notes and you're going to be filling them in as you go. So the first thing we're going to do here is we're going to watch a little clip. This is from Monty Python, and it gives a kind of humorous portrayal of the feudal system.
Treat me like an inferior.
Well, I am king.
Oh, king, eh? Very nice. And how do you get that, eh? By exploiting the workers. By hanging on to outdated imperialist dogma, which perpetuates the economic and social differences in our society. Is there ever going to be any progress?
There is some lovely filth down here. Oh. How do you do?
How do you do, good lady? I'm Arthur, king of the Britons. Whose castle is that?
King of who?
The Britons.
Who are the Britons?
Well, we all are. We are all Britons. And I am your king.
I didn't know we had a king. I thought we were an autonomous collective.
You're fooling yourself. We're living in a dictatorship. A self-perpetuating autocracy in which the working classes...
Oh, there you go, bringing class into it again.
That's what it's all about. If only people would
hear... Please, please, good people. I am in haste. Who lives in that castle?
No one lives there.
Then who is your lord?
We don't have a lord.
What?
I told you, we're an anarcho-syndicalist commune. We take it in turns to act as a sort of executive officer for the week.
Yes.
But all the decisions of that officer have to be ratified at a special bi-weekly meeting.
Yes, I see.
By a simple majority in the case of purely internal affairs.
Be quiet.
But by a two-thirds majority in the case of...
Be quiet. I order you to be quiet.
Order? Who do you think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Well, how do you become king, then?
The Lady of the Lake, her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite, held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds, distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
But you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
I mean, if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened bint had lobbed a scimitar at me, they'd put me away!
Shut up! Will you shut up?
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system.
Shut up!
Oh, come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help! Help! I'm being repressed! Bloody peasant!
Oh, what a giveaway! Do you hear that? Do you hear that, eh?
That's what I'm on about. Do you see him repressing me? You saw it, didn't you?
So, what you just saw depicted is feudalism, And feudalism is a social order that developed in Europe after the fall of the Roman Empire, and it existed until about the 1400s with the emergence of absolutist leaders and the Renaissance, and we will learn about those later in the week. And then we'll talk at the end of this lecture about the economic system called the manor system, which supported feudalism. So let's go through and learn about each of these things. So why did feudalism develop? Well, there was something called the Roman Empire, and it had a strong centralized government, but the problem is the Roman Empire fell apart. And with that lack of leadership, you had small, more localized ruling. And that meant that people still needed protection from being attacked, possibly. So they gave their allegiance to a king. And a lot of times those kings were ruled over a smaller area of people. And then they had lords that were beneath the king, and then knights, and then the peasants or the masses. So you kind of had a four-tiered system or structure. And the goal was to work together to help each other. So how does feudalism work? It is going to be a top-down system. We call this hierarchy, where the king's in charge or the monarch, and then there's nobles or lords, and we use that term interchangeably, beneath them. And those nobles and lords are most likely going to have the interactions with the knights and the peasants on a monthly, daily, maybe weekly basis. It just really depended on how big of a territory a king controlled. But most people would not interact with a king. They would interact with the nobles of their area. So here is the system. We usually use a pyramid to just depict this. So you have the monarch at the top. You have a noble or lord beneath them who is controlling like the day-to-day operations of a manor. And a knight was someone who was trained to protect. And so those were your soldiers. A lot of times people called them mercenaries because they went to the highest bidder. They would fight for you if you paid them. And then the majority of people would be serfs or peasants, and they would be doing the farming, and they would have pretty difficult lives. So we're going to go through each one of these things. Just remember, a monarch is a king or queen. They own territory. And then in order to control all of the territory they own, they can't be there every day. They can't oversee it. So they granted what are called fiefs, or small blocks of land, or smaller blocks of land, to nobles. And then nobles were in charge of taking care of those, and they would pay taxes to the king or queen for the use of the land. And they also would have to pledge knights in order to protect the land for the king or queen. So there's always a pledge of loyalty or service that goes on between all of the different groups of people in our hierarchy. So, and then the most important way or payment is land. So people get land, and that is very important in a feudal system, because the most important thing you can do with land is grow food on it. So what would happen is, once you're given a piece of land by the king or queen, you become a vassal to that king or queen. And that means that you are in service to them. After the monarch, the next tier in the hierarchy are your nobles and lords. They are serving the monarch. Oftentimes they're called dukes or barons or earls. They just often have titles, and a lot of times they'll have a coat of arms, like you see in the bottom right-hand corner here, for their family. And they are considered the rulers of the local territories. They will use the land that they're given, at least a portion of it, by the monarch to oftentimes establish a manor. And we'll get into what that manor is, but it's essentially a farm and a community that is going to support the local lords, and then the local lord would then turn around and support the monarch. So in exchange for the noble's promise to send a certain number of soldiers to protect the monarch whenever the monarch calls, or to wage war if the monarch decides, they also have to pay the monarch taxes. So that manor system is going to help to create income for the lords so that they can then reimburse the monarchs. The knights would be under the lords. The knights' jobs are to wage war. So they start training from early on, from the age of six, in horsemanship and warfare. A lot of times the monarchs will, when they give the nobles the land, the nobles will often take that land and give pieces of it to the knights as a way to pay them for their services. And so that made the knights oftentimes very powerful, and sometimes they could be more powerful in some situations than a neighboring noble who maybe has a smaller amount of land. Knights would go from noble to noble and pledge their loyalty if they felt like it could cause them to gain more power. So sometimes you had knights that even became very, very powerful. Knights can serve a noble directly, getting support and the right to live on the noble's manor instead of land. So if for some reason the knight didn't want to have their own land, they could just go ahead and live on the land of the noble. So the knights had a couple of options, and they had a good opportunity to become powerful. The serfs, on the other hand, are the commoners and peasants, and they lived on the manors of monarchs, nobles, or knights. And in exchange for having a small portion of land that they were able to farm and produce food from, and a place where they could build and shelter, build a small house and shelter themselves, they had to work for the person's land that they were living on. So if they were living on a noble's land, they would have to work for them. And then anytime they weren't working for them, they could work on their own small piece of land. And so their labor was a form of taxation. So by working for free, essentially, they were paying off the cost of their land. Serfs were what would be called tied to the land, which meant that they couldn't leave the noble and go somewhere else because they had promised, remember that this loyalty, they had promised to work for this noble. So they couldn't leave without the noble's permission. And for the most part, peasants did not move very far. They did not go very far in their lives. The average lifespan, I believe, was 30 years old, and they didn't go more than about 2 miles from their houses. So they had very challenging lives. They did not live very long, and they worked very hard. So just to review, feudalism grew out of the chaos of the Roman Empire. It's based on a system of granting land, in exchange for loyalty and military service. It provides order and security and stability in some form of government. And serfs could farm some land on a manor and receive protection of the noble in exchange for their labor. We're going to watch a little quick review of this system from Crash Course. We're just going to watch the first 4 minutes. So we'll go to that right now.
Hi there, my name is John Green, this is Crash Course World History, and today we're going to talk about the Dark Ages, possibly the most egregious Eurocentrism in all of history, which is really saying something. We're Europe! The Prime Meridian runs through us, we're in the middle of every map, and we get to be a continent even though we're not a continent. But let's begin today with a pop quiz. What was the best year of your life? And what was the worst year?
Mr. Green!
Best 1994, worst 1990. Oh, me from the past. It gets so much better, and also so much worse. For worst year, I'm gonna go with 2001. Best year, 2006. All right, now it's your turn, dear pupil. Share your best and worst years in comments during the intro. Right, so what you'll quickly find is that your worst year was someone else's best year. So too with history. The period between 600 and 1450 CE is often called the Middle Ages in Europe because it came between the Roman Empire, assuming you forget about the Byzantines, and the beginning of the Modern Age. And it's sometimes called the Dark Ages because it was so purportedly unenlightened. But was the age really so dark? Depends on what you find depressing. If you like cities and great poetry, then the Dark Ages were indeed pretty dark in Europe. But if, like me, your two favorite things are not dying from wars and not dying from anything else, then the Dark Ages actually weren't that bad, at least until the plague came in the 14th century. And meanwhile, outside of Europe, the Dark Ages were truly an age of enlightenment. But we'll get boring Europe out of the way first. Let's go to the thought bubble. Medieval Europe had less trade, fewer cities, and less cultural output than the original Roman Empire. London and Paris were fetid fire traps with none of the planning or sewage management of places 5,000 years older, like Mohenjo-Daro in the Indus Valley civilization, let alone Rome. But with fewer powerful governments, wars were at least smaller, which is one reason why Europeans living in medieval times... Ugh, thought bubble, I knew you were gonna do that! Anyway, people in medieval times lived slightly longer, life expectancy was 30, than Europeans during the Roman Empire, when life expectancy was 28. Instead of centralized governments, Europe in the Middle Ages had feudalism, a political system based on reciprocal relationships between lords, who owned lots of land, and vassals, who protected the land and got to dress up as knights in exchange for pledging loyalty to the lords. The lords were also vassals to more important lords, with the most important of all being the king. Below the knights were peasants who did the actual work on the land in exchange for protection from bandits and other threats. Feudalism was also an economic system, with the peasants working the land and keeping some of their production to feed themselves while giving the rest to the landowner whose land they worked. The small-scale local nature of the feudal system was perfect for a time and place where the threats to people's safety were also small-scale and local. But of course, this system reinforces the status quo. There's little freedom and absolutely no social mobility. Peasants could never work their way up to lords, and they almost never left their villages. Thanks, Thought Bubble. One more point that's really interesting from a world history perspective. This devolution from empire to localism has happened in lots of places at lots of different times. And in times of extreme political stress, like after the fall of the Han Dynasty in China, power tends to flow into the hands of local lords who can protect the peasants better than the state can. We hear a lot about this in Chinese history and also in contemporary Afghanistan, but instead of being called feudal lords, these landlords are called warlords. You're...
All right, so hopefully that helps to review a little bit about what the system of feudalism looked like. And it also kind of introduced our new topic, which is this manor system. So first, let's go through a couple weaknesses of the feudal system. Just so you know, because of the way it was set up, it did lead to constant warfare, oftentimes between different monarchs and their nobles. So a lot of warfare. Yes, it was smaller scale, maybe not as deadly, but it just was kind of the expectation that war was inevitable. Also, the strength of the monarch was only as secure as the loyalty of his nobles. So there was always this sense that you needed to make sure that your nobles stayed in line. And if your nobles decided to become an ally of a different monarch, then you were out of luck. So over time, these fiefs became so small as people fought, and fiefs again are the land, they could not support an entire manor anymore. And so you started to see the economic system of some of the nobles in certain areas crumble as they started to lose land to other nobles. So when knights and nobles lose land, they don't have anything to keep them in place. And so there it contributes to constant warfare as they go out and try to conquer to gather more for themselves. All right, so the manor system. The manor system is the economic system that supports feudalism. So the estate of a knight or noble lives on is called a fief of land. Each manor was designed in the same basic way. So the management of resources on the manor and its economy became known as the manor system. So the goal of a manor is to be self-sufficient. So you don't ever have to leave your castle gates or your area so that you are stronger, because if you have to depend on any other manor or any other noble, then you are at a weakened position. So again, why do they need self-sufficiency? It's because there was constant warfare and you were always at threat of being attacked. So you can't rely on your neighbor. During the Middle Ages, or some would call Dark Ages, you had very little commerce. Commerce is the term we use for trade. So instead of these different manors working together and each one only producing a certain thing and specializing, they didn't do that. They produced everything for their community because they didn't want to have to depend on another community. So it really did actually decrease the economic power of the area because everything was local. In short, you could not be sure where your next shipment of food, where your weapons or anything was going to come from. So you always needed to make sure that you were able to take care of your own people. And the most expensive thing a manor had to do is to arm its soldiers. So you needed to keep your manor as wealthy as possible, and sending money to a merchant outside or a traveling salesperson or something outside of your community would actually make it so you had less money. So a manor was based around a manor house or a castle. So you would have a castle in the middle. So here's our manor house over here on the right. This is where the noble, or if you were working for a knight, this is where a knight would live. Fields were divided into three sections, one for spring plantings, one for fall plantings, and one that was called a fallow field. And a fallow field, we'll learn a little bit about this, but soil would become what's called exhausted if you used it during every season. So one of the three would always be sitting empty in order to allow it to replenish the nutrients so it could grow another good crop. So how did this manor system work? Well, if you're going to keep everything internal and make sure that nothing has to go out of your manor, you would have your own mill to grind grain. The noble's going to own this mill. And even though peasants might have some of their own land, in order to grind their grain, they're going to have to use the mill owned by the manor. And so as a result, they are going to have to pay a fee. So of course, a lot of peasants, they're already paying a fee with their own labor 5 days a week a lot of times. They only get to work on their own farm on the weekends for 2 days. And then once they harvest something for themselves, they have to pay to grind it, which got to be very expensive and frustrating for them. So manors often, if they were lucky, they would have their own pond where you could fish for eels and some fish to supply free for your food. However, what was sad about this is you were not allowed to fish if you were a peasant unless you got specific permission from the lord or the knight. So that was something that was owned and controlled by the lord and the knights. So for peasants, their diet was mainly going to be vegetables and grain. They did not have access to a lot of protein. Animals, pigs, cows, goats, a lot of times they would roam freely in the common pasture land. But again, for peasants, you were not allowed to actually kill those animals. That would be considered poaching, and poaching could result in you being executed. So stick with your vegetables and your grain. Each manor also would provide a church because everybody needed to go to church. Here you can see the church, and the parson's house, which would be the priest's house, would be right next to it. And that was supposed to be paid by the noble. Well, the noble, of course, how do they pay for things? With the work of the peasants. So again, only nobles could hunt wild game in the fields and forest, and most often only nobles were allowed to fish in the pond unless they got unless the peasants got permission. It was not for them either. The priest of each manor, their job was to marry and bury and baptize. So when you were born, you would baptize infants. When people were ready to be married, you would perform the marriage ceremony, and when people died, you would give them their last rites. And then once a week you would perform mass. And attending mass and receiving the sacraments was essential to getting into heaven. So everybody would gather on Sundays at the church. So how did the manor system support feudalism? It divides a monarch's land among loyal nobles who then take care and protect and defend that land and make it profitable. And then the manors then give money and income to the monarch or king, and then knights when necessary to defend the monarch or king. So it really is a great system for the monarchs or kings. The problem with this system, though, over time, is you start to see some nobles desiring more power and kings getting frustrated. And so you're going to have a point at which you're going to start to have disagreements between the nobles and the kings about who is stronger. And in different ways, different areas figure out how to balance this. In Western Europe, most of the times the kings will take power away from the nobles and make themselves more powerful, and that would be called absolutism. But if you get over into Eastern Europe, feudalism and that system remained until the 1700s, 1800s. So it lasted a lot longer. And that is the end of our lecture. So go ahead and finish answering all of your questions that are on your paper. And then if you have any additional questions, make sure you contact your teacher.